Today I want to show you how to build a pyramid-style commercial crawfish trap. And this is the most widespread and popularized version of industrial crawfish farming trap used down here in the South. Now there's several different reasons why this trap is used so much. For one thing, it's durable. It's very efficient. It's very effective. But the idea is that this trap is going to be around for a long time. Today we're going to be using 19-gauge galvanized steel. This is going to be half-inch. And that means it's going to last 10, 15, 20 years if put up properly. Now what we're using to push this wire together are J-clips. These are also made out of galvanized steel, which means they're going to be around just as long as this mesh is. Now, if you've already seen me twisting this around, you can see the entrances. You can vary the sizes of those, modify them as needed depending on what kind of crawfish and what size you're getting. And there are three of them. So equidistant all the way around makes it very easy for whatever you're trapping to find those entrances and get inside. Now, up here on top, this is what makes this thing so effective as far as industrial purposes. The majority of time checking crawfish traps is going to be spent opening up the trap and dumping things out. And if you've got 100 or 1,000 traps, that can definitely slow down your operation, especially if you're checking them several times a day. This up here is 4-inch drain pipe. It's not PVC, it's drain pipes, which makes it very thin wall, a little more flexible, and not as heavy. And that's a very important thing whenever you're throwing this out, so that you're not getting it top heavy. But the idea is that whenever you are checking the trap, you can check them and dump the crawfish very easily and very quickly. So flipping it over, a couple shakes, all the crawfish come out, you throw it back in the water, you throw your bait bag back in, and within moments, you're on to the next trap. And that's the idea. So very effective, very efficient, and it saves a heck of a lot of time. Now, the only downside we have here is that there is a limitation as to how deep the water can be when you throw this trap in. Ideally, this spout needs to be above the water level. So you do have to be mindful of that. You might have to put weights here in the bottom to make sure it stays down. Otherwise, this trap has been absolutely amazing. And so I'm going to go ahead and show you how to build that right now. About a $7 trap, half an hour build. I'll show you how it's done. All right. So the trap that we're making today is going to be an exact replica of the one we just showed you. Okay, so this one right here on the side. You can make these traps any size you want. Smaller works. I wouldn't go any larger, though. You can use a variety of materials, but a half-inch galvanized works well for me. I also use eighth-inch every once in a while, but that takes a little bit more practice because more metal means it's harder to bend some of these things. Now, the main idea as far as getting started is that you have to have the right size mesh, okay? And this is going to be a 2-foot by 4-foot piece, so 48 squares all the way across, 24 inches. And for this long length right here, this is going to be 48 inches, which means 96 squares. It's a half inch. And as long as you start out with the right size, everything else just kind of falls into place. So what I'm going to take is this thing and kind of spread it out a little bit. And the first step is going to be taking the J-hooks and putting these two pieces together. All right, you're going to meet them up all the way down using the J-clips, and you're going to make them, or make this, into a cylinder. All right, pretty easy start. So, if you haven't already seen some of the other trapping videos where I've used these, the concept is pretty easy. These are J-clip pliers, pretty cheap, about $13. They'll work forever. The J-clips themselves, we're going to use about 40 of them on this, and that comes out to about 60 cents per trap. So, pretty cheap. All you gotta do is load that J-clip. A little bit of dexterity. Make sure everything's lined up. The biggest issue you're probably gonna have right here is making sure that your wires come together. You can do two different things here. One is to actually hook the pliers up underneath. The other is to bend the cylinder together. That gives you a better profile to get the clamp. You're going to crimp together, okay, a little bit of force, And that's the idea. All right, so those pieces of wire are met together. We're going to go ahead and skip two boxes, and we'll do the next one all the way down until this is a continuous cylinder. A little bit of practice, buy extra J-clips, more than you need. Practice makes perfect, though. Go ahead and speed this video up, and we'll get on to the next step. Alright, and there's your cylinder. Okay, all the way through, evenly spaced out, what you want. Right. Now at this point, we're going to go ahead and start closing up ends. So for the first one, I'm going to take our seam that we've just made right here. I'm going to push it in all the way, just like this, and start to bend it a little bit. Start to look like a pillow trap, but the next step after we get this thing sealed over, I'll show you that it's not going to turn out the same way. So what we're going to do right now is go ahead and take the J-clips once more, and we're going to seal all the way across this lip. So start on one side, go all the way to the other. The squares have got to be lined up just right. The only other thing that you want to be very, very aware of is that you want to start about 4 or 5 squares back on the two corners, okay? Because these are going to be inverted, these are going to become the actual funnel entrances for your trap. So, line them up, get it started. More J-clips. Kind of finish off this end a little unevenly. But there we go, all the way across. Now, before we go ahead and seal up the other end, we're going to invert these funnels right here. It makes it a lot easier to get it done. This is heavy gauge wire. You are going to have to use some muscle and most definitely gloves to get this step done. So, you do not want to slip on this. Be very deliberate, but you're gonna have to use some force. Alright, so we're gonna be inverting these two corners in to make funnels. And it's gonna be a rough job at first. After a while, we will go ahead and modify them, clean them up a little bit, make them look pretty. The idea at first is just to get the lion's share of the work knocked out. First things first, open them up just a little bit, and from here it's just a matter of working it down. I'm going to try and push this thing down, and I'm going to push the funnel back into itself. And some of them will make you look awesome, some of them will take a lot of time and frustrate the heck out of you. Work at it. There's a little bit of technique to it. I find using both thumbs. Effective most days. Otherwise, just bend the heck out of it. So this one is not cooperating. from making dozens of these traps. Finally found one. Doesn't agree with me. So you just gotta work at it. And like you're seeing right here, at times, it can be frustrating. Just like that. As long as the funnel has gotten a good start on it, you can come back and you can modify and bend it further later on. Right now, the inversion is the important part. Let's go ahead and try this one. See if I can make it look a little more seamless. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Alright, and there's our start. Now that we've inverted our first two funnels, roughly, it's time to go ahead and make our last seam. And this is where we're going to diverge from a typical pillow trap design. So typically with pillow traps, we would go ahead and bend just like we had made that last seam, and both of them would line up. So that last one, this one, and we'd have pretty much a trap that sat and laid just like this. With this pyramid trap, we're going to take a different angle. So right here at this seam, which would normally just come back and meet right in the middle, we're gonna make the seam into the edge. So this was the last seam. We're going to now take these two pieces together, line them up, and take our J-clips and fasten all the way down. Alright, just as we've done the other ones. So there's your seam right there. This is the new seam. So whenever this is done, it'll sit like a pyramid, just like that. So, alright, more fun with J-clips. Alright, there we go. Before I invert the last entrance, the third entrance, I need to find out which of these sides will work best as a base, because I want to make sure that this pyramid sits flat on the bottom as well as possible. You don't want it to be off-centered, because then it's more likely to tip over. So you can try a couple different variations out. The idea is that one of these has got to be the top, and one has got to be the third entrance. So if you see right there, we have a bit of an issue. It's going to knock over. So right there, the seam is on the bottom for this one, pretty well squared up, and so our last entrance is going to be this one right here. So we're going to go ahead and see if we can't invert it at this time, all right, just like the others. Gloves and a lot of patience. A little rough, but we've got it started. Okay. So one of the last things we're going to do before polishing this off and taking care of a few of the cosmetic issues, we're going to cut a circle out of here. And you want to be very careful as you cut this that you don't actually try and go for the exact size. So a lot of people are going to get into the issue of cutting too much, and all of a sudden the pipe slides all the way through. So the best advice I can give you is to make the hole small at first and then clip ribbons down the edges so that you can kind of peel it back, and that way you have plenty of wire to affix your pipe to. And you can cut several times, but if you cut too big, you can't put the wire back. That's the idea. So, using the pliers, the wire nippers, let's go ahead and start shaving off the top of this a little bit. So that's our initial cut right there. Now it's time to start slicing down the sides just a little bit. We'll probably have to go ahead and take a little bit more off, but that's no problem. Measure twice, cut once, or if you're like me, just cut a bunch of little times. Back a little bit. Take a little bit of trial and error to get the right size. It's not quite right just yet. It's getting there. And yeah, I know. I need to have some spring-loaded wire nippers. I'm feeling it. Go. Right, so there we go. Pipes in, nice and tight, good and snug. There's a few more things that we need to do before this trap is ready to set out. Now the last real big step is going to be to drill holes all the way around the base of this pipe. About a half inch up, all the way around, and we're going to be using some of the wire that was used to roll up our hardware cloth to effectively sew the pipe to the trap. Okay, so back, forth, back, forth. You don't want this to ever come out. You want to be very, very mindful of the pipe's placement as well. So whenever you have it on its base, it needs to be straight up and down, not weird, not to the side. And the depth of the pipe is even more important. So if you have this pipe down here, whenever you flip the trap over to get all of whatever's gotten in there out, if you have this gap all the way around, it's going to get trapped in there. And it's going to be very hard for you to retrieve whatever you've caught. You're going to want to back this thing off until this funnel leads into the pipe easily, so that whenever you flip it, it works out better for you. Clip off, bend back, make sure that there are no jagged or pointy edges sticking out, stuff that's going to actually get caught on things in the water, or perhaps you yourself, and scratch you up. We're going to mess with the funnels a little bit more, make sure that we have the right sizes. Whatever your federal, state, local laws are, make sure that you are following them as far as the trap dimensions are concerned. We're going to deepen those funnels a little bit more, make sure that they're really good guides and entrances to allow things to come in, but discourage them from being able to leave. Other than that, I usually take the pliers, crimp some of these J-hooks down just a little bit more. It worked really well to have them able to roll whenever you're building the trap, but now that it's pretty much put together, crimping it flat and making sure that there's no give, probably a good idea. But let's go ahead and finish this thing up and give it a try. All right, so here's our completed trap, just about ready to be baited and chunked out. Gone ahead and modified the funnels to make sure the entrance sizes are large, and we've deepened them. We made sure that they go far to the interior so that everything that gets inside stays inside better. Now up here on top, we've affixed the pipe completely. That is what the inside needs to look like. Okay, so nice and smooth profile so that the crawfish and whatever else you're trapping only come out whenever you turn this trap over. Otherwise, they should stay in the bottom. So last thing we want to do is go ahead and affix a gear tag and rope. Easy enough. The way that I do this is to make a loop with an overhand knot. I'll go ahead and thread that into at least two of the wires to make sure I don't pull any loose. And once I've gotten that loop all the way through, not all the way through, I'll simply tie a lark's head all the way through. And that's a knot that does not fail me. Works out real well. Okay. Now, a couple downsides to this trap. One thing, if you've noticed, it has to stay upright. So if this trap falls over at all, it's likely that you're going to lose most, if not all, your bait. So you want to make sure that you've got it on a flat bottom, flat base. I've had it flip over once. It's once every 50, but it hurts whenever you lose that. The other thing is that since I used half-inch mesh for my dry dog food, which is my preferred bait, I have to put it into a mesh bag. So your onion bags, garlic bags, things like that, I use a cut-up loofah. Works out real well. Otherwise, we are ready to go. Let's go ahead and chuck this out. See what we catch. All right. First time to charm. We set out two of these traps and check them every couple hours. Sometimes it doesn't take very long, but it's pretty hot out here. Hadn't already noticed. One more to go. Trap number two. There we go. Wish it luck. A little slippery. So yeah, check that out. About 2 hours. This thing is full of cichlids, bluegill, and a few crawfish. Show you how easy it is to dump these things out. Bait bag's still good. Take a look. Awesome, huh? That is an effective, efficient trap. Now again, here in Texas, put that back up. Here in Texas, we could only take the crawfish from that trap, so everything's about to get thrown back in. But it depends on where you're at. Go ahead and check the other trap. Back in the water, kids. All right, second trap. Oh man, look at that. That is not bad, especially for the time of day we're looking at right here. So again, right over. Take your bait bag. Just about decimated that one. They were hungry. Take a look at all these guys. These are your Rio Grande cichlids right here with all the spots. That is a crawfish, a red swamp crawfish. There's your cichlid. And things like a bluegill perch. Man, that is awesome. All right. So that is right at 2 hours, guys. Put these back in. Back to the water you go. None left behind. Well, that pretty much shows you just how much potential that trap has. And I've had pretty much this exact same gains every time I've set it. Cuts down on time, very efficient. When I do set it out at nighttime, I make sure that I set it out a little deeper or further out in the middle, because it is visible for the crawfish, or rather for the raccoons to see. So you want to be mindful of that. Otherwise, all about this trap. But hope you learned something, guys. Like and subscribe. And as always, till next time.